Everybody, happy Friday. We're still waiting on a few more people. I know it's been a long week. It's been a long week for us as well. And we'd like to thank everybody for the feedback that we've got over the last few days. I have lots of notes on the veritable yellow note-keeping paper that I do, just so that we can look at things and go over things. So there's a few things that we're going to do today and a few deliverables that we are going to give to you. We will start this morning working back in our project that we've been working on, and we're going to talk a little bit about the NAVEX, the IMU first this morning. Once we look at that NAVEX and the IMU, we're then going to talk about the gamepad control. The gamepad control is what we use to test the functionality of the robot and to make sure it's working. And in addition to that, it's what we're going to use as part of some utilities that we're going to provide to you today so that you can actually enable the robot and you can make it work. So we still are finishing off some text on the gamepad control. But what the guys did yesterday was they created a utility that they will share with you that you can run that will allow you to enable the robot, disable the robot, and get data on the shuffleboard. Okay, so you can use that for all of your purposes. What we're actually trying to do in the full gamepad control is integrate some technology into it that we are going to use for the future and that we are going to use in other robotics things that we work through here at Studica. So the utility that we give you for our purposes for World Skills will work perfect. It's clean and it's simple to do. After that, what we'll do today is we're going to create command structure inside of your project. This will enable us to do joystick control, like I said, of the robot after we do the gamepad control. We're then going to digress a little and switch over and do some vision. So James has a couple of vision examples so that you can see how you add vision to the project and how you can use the SR Pro camera. After that, you'll notice that so far when we've used the trainer, what we've done is we've only got one motor because that's all we're driving. So we are going to add two more motors to the robot. And once we add the two more motors, we will then show you how you can drive the robot. So we'll take the robot. You'll notice that Derek worked very, very hard. Okay. And has completely finished his robot that we started the other day. Okay. So it's all done and we're all ready to go. So we will drive that robot. We may even take that robot and put it out on the court. No, just kidding, Bob. We're not going to actually take it and put it out on the court. Just our court is set up for testing. So I just wanted to scare Bob because I noticed he was on this morning. We went through. So we may drive it on the floor here, or I'll hold it up, or we have a different blank court that we could actually drive it on that has no testing configuration on it. Okay. So let's begin and talk about the NAVEX this morning. Just give you a quick overview. Okay. Once we get that up. So the NAVEX is the now internal. So the IMU, the inertial measurement unit, is built into the system. We've now integrated that into the VMX. So it's all integrated in the robot controller together. It's going to have three gyroscopes, three accelerometers, and three magnetometers in it. It also now includes or has an integrated motion processor, which will process the data from those sensors and generate the measurements for both angular orientation and linear acceleration. Okay. It's a little bit updated on this, so it is a nine-axis. It's based on the nine-axis InvinSense NPU 9250, right? And there's a couple of points to understand, and James had talked about it briefly, but I do suggest that you read through all of the notes on the IMU if you're going to look at it so that you can see it. Okay. Since the body and frame board coordinates need to be aligned because the yaw axis needs to be aligned, okay? The default orientation for the VMX, and I'll let James talk about it, is with the logo up or the board facing up, and that is the Y axis of the circuit board. So the Studica logo and the VMX logo on your VMX, that is the top, that is the Y axis, okay? So generally, if you're gonna test or work through certain things, that would be the top of the robot or the front of the robot, okay? If you have a different orientation, such as vertically, horizontally, upside down, you can use the Omni mount feature and transform the orientation, right? But out of the box, that's gonna be the default orientation. There's a couple of other things to remember, and it's not really that much of an issue right now because of the way that we power up first now, and then you have to enable the robot. But you have to remember that when you first turn it on, it needs to self-calibrate, and that takes some time. So we had noticed in the past that people would turn on their robot and start running it right away. And you know, a lot of times it hadn't properly calibrated, so it will keep trying to recalibrate. Now your robot's going to be on, so it'll have time to sit there and boot up and calibrate, and then you will enable communication to it, so it shouldn't be a problem. Okay. You will need to add the NavX library the same way that other libraries have been added. Okay. This will allow you to successfully create and configure everything when you're going to do it. Please remember that in order to add a library, you must first create and configure the project, okay? So that's the reason why I got yelled at the other day because I was trying to add a vendor library. So I just went on to the software side of the programming here in the docs page, and I opened up VS Code and I went add vendor library. But I had not yet properly created a project, okay, and configured that project. So you really need, when you are going to work through this each time, if you're just getting going on it, follow those steps. So create the project, configure the project for VMS, review your base project outline, and then add your vendor library. So that's the only reason I put this slide up there, was please remember that, okay? Otherwise, you're not going to get the correct options when you're inside VS Code. All right. And that was it. I'll pass this back over to James, and he'll begin to introduce the NavX. And I'm sure he's going to import the NavX library and show you how that all goes together. So thank you. 32.
You answer. So today we're going to add the NavX. So to add the NavX, if you go down to Vendor Depth, you can see that we don't have that library installed yet. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to the docs page. Now, if you remember inside programming, there's adding vendor libraries. And if we scroll down, we can see the NavX library. So we're going to copy that link, go back to our project, click on the WPI command palette, manage vendor libraries, and we're going to install a new library online. We're going to add that link in, hit enter. It will ask us to build, which we want to do, so we're going to hit yes. And it will now build and cache that library into our project. And as you can see, we got a build successful, so we are essentially good to go. Now, to add the NavX, we're going to use the ARS class in sensors. So we're going to go private AHRS, as you can see, the class is here. I'm going to name it Gyro, or we can name it Navex. Up to you. I like naming it Gyro.
That's what you're going to use. That's what you're going to use it mostly for. Call it Gyro. Yeah. That way you understand a little bit better.
I also want to add a network table entry so that we can display the value of the Navex. So, private network table entry. This one I will call Navex. So if we remember from yesterday, I created a network table entry to pass it along to the shuffleboard. I'm adding this entry. That the entry will be called yaw value as a default value of 0. And then the entry will apply the entry to the shuffleboard. Okay, now I need to instantiate the library. Gyro equals new ours. Now, if we remember, we have to display what the port is that the Navex is connected to. In this case, we're going to use the internal SPI bus. SPI.port.km. So you notice it's giving me an error because SPI is not imported. But there's a weird where it won't choose the right SPI. So we're going to import it manually. So import edu.wpi.first, wpi.lib.j.spi. As you can see now, there is no more error. So what we've done is we've said that the RS port, which is the Navex, is attached to the internal SPI, which is spi.port.kmxp. All this does is there's two SPI ports, and we are telling the compiler that we are connected to the internal port. So now that it's instantiated, we want to create an accessor method in order to read the gyro. Public double get yaw. So as you can see, we have the error again because we have not returned the double. So we're going to return gyro dot get. Oh no, let me get the get yaw. Then let's add a comment. This method will return the yaw value from the internal. Add the space, returns yaw value range of -180 here. Now when we hover over this, we know returns the yaw value of the internal Navex with a range of -180 degrees to 180. Now, if I also wanted to zero the yaw value, I could create a mutator. So this is where we're going to set the yaw to 0. So we're going to say gyro. Zero yaw. So what this does, it will zero the yaw value that we can then recalibrate where the robot is. So if we're in a known location, for example, at the start of the match, we can then zero the yaw and go back and forth, and our robot will know where it is. So let's add the comment. You can just say zeros, Now we also want to be able to display the navex. So we're going to add here navex dot set double, and it'll be get. Simple as that. So now when we launch this, we'll be able to see the navex on our shuffleboard, if we remember right here. So now that the navex is added, there's only two things left that we need to create. That is a command and the gamepad class. So let's start by creating the gamepad class. To create the gamepad class, I'm going to right click on Java here, which is the main folder, to create a new folder. I'm going to name this folder gamepad. So inside gamepad, another question. Inside gamepad, we are going to create a new file. The first file we're going to call is gamepad constants dot Java. So this is where we are going to map out the PlayStation controller and all its buttons based on the way that the control center will read and interpret that data. So let's start off by calling the package FRC robot. We're then going to create the class. You notice we're not extending anything as we're just creating a constants class. This would be the same as a header class in C++. We're going to define the port. Which in this case is the public. We're going to make it equal to 0. Well, then we're going to define the buttons on the controller. I will show you after how we actually get these buttons. So, okay, I'm just gonna copy it in from the example project, so I'm not gonna sit here and type it out for you. Okay. So if we remember, these are all the pins. Now to figure out what button is what, I'm going to open up the driver station to show it. Okay, so here we have the driver station. If I go to the controller section here, we can notice that this is port 0. It doesn't show it, but we know that's port 0. Then we have 13 buttons and some axes. If I press the X button, we notice that 1 lights up. So we're going to have to change this to 1. Then we want the square button So if I hit square, it's zero. So I have to change this to zero. Now we would do the same thing for everything here in order to line up our buttons. Now for the joysticks, if I move the left joystick in the Y direction, so that's this variable right here, we can see that I'm moving axis one. So I'm correct there. Then I'm going to move the left analog in the X direction. And we can see axis zero is moving. So that's correct. I'm not going to move the right analog joystick in the X direction. And we can see it's channel two. Now, if we look at the right analog Y, I'm moving channel three and not channel five. So I need to now change this to three. And therefore it now works based on this. The buttons are a bit not mapped correctly, but we can go ahead and change that later. So that essentially shows you how to map out your controller here. If you were to plug in an Xbox 360 controller, for example, then it would have a different button map and you'd have to remap it here. If you plugged in the Logitech controller, it would also have a different map, very similar, but you'd have to remap. And this controller section can accept most USB controllers or joysticks that get plugged into your computer. You can even use the old flight joystick if you wanted to drive your robot around. That's up to you. Go ahead and close this. Someone's asking, can I use a DualShock 4 as well, PS4? Yes, you can. That's what I'm using right here.
Yeah, we'll deal with that. Assuming it's not connected. So therefore, you get no data. But we'll get to that.
Yeah.
The question in the chat about the shuffleboard and getting no data, there's a couple of things that could be going wrong. So we'll just do a few things and we'll get to that, okay, rather than stop and discuss it right now. So I do have the question open and we will get and look at it.
So now that we're done the gamepad constants class, we can actually create the operator instruction class. So to do that, we're going to right click on the gamepad folder, create new file. I'm going to call it oi.java. This stands for operator instructions. Enter, and we've now created the class. So it's going to be part of the package. We want to create our class, so public class OR. We're then going to import the joystick class so that we can create joystick object. So what we've done is we've imported the joystick class and we've created the object. The joystick class allows us to interpret and parse the data coming from the controller. We have to create a constructor. And then we're going to initialize the drive pad. So drive pad equal to new joystick. Now, if you remember, we created the gamepad constants. So I'm going to call that constants. So gamepad constants. I'm looking for the USB port that this joystick is on, which we defined here. I'm now good to go. So what's nice about the gamepad constants class is that we can keep our operator instructor class exactly the same. And if we're mapping out a new controller, we can just come in here and change the values. And we don't have to go in here and change everything manually again. So now let's figure out how we can interpret the right drive y-axis. So we're going to create a public double get right drive y. Double join drive and dot get axis gamepad constants dot. Now we're going to look for right analog y. So I'm just going to type it out quickly and then we can go over it after. So what we're doing here is we are grabbing the axis itself, assigning it to the variable joy. We are then creating an absolute of joy and checking if it is less than 0.05. If it's less than 0.05, then return 0. Otherwise, we return the full value of joy. This is because we need to create a dead zone on the axes of the controller. As joysticks are never perfectly right at zero when you snap them back to their home location. So we have to create a dead zone that's normally plus or minus 5%, which is what this is. So the drive pad get raw axis will return a value of -1 to 1. So when we do an absolute value and we check if it's less than 0.05, we are doing that plus or minus 5% dead zone area. Of course, you could increase this if you want, but now it's 10%. But this is up to you. I like the default of 5%. However, you can increase it based on if your controller is a little bit damaged, maybe you need to increase it on that axis, etc., etc. I also want to create a Java doc here to explain what this does. I don't need to put in, I just need to put in the return statement. So it returns the Y axis value from drive pad right joystick. So now if I try and call this from outside, it'll tell me this returns the Y axis value from the drive pad right joystick. I'm like, okay, good. So that's how you do this axis. The code is exactly the same for all three other axes, except you're using a different constant. So let's show how to do read a button on the controller. So in this case, I'm going to read the X button. So public boolean get. So this one's simple. All I'm going to do is return get raw button, and we're going to use our gamepad constants class. I'm going to look for X button. And that's it to try and read a button. So it will return back a true if the button's pressed or a false if it's not pressed. And we're going to then create a Java doc. So it returns a true or false. Depending on the input. And then we can repeat that for all the other buttons on the controller. Of course, it gets repetitive for this class, but once it's done, you're normally good to go. And you just have to change the gamepad constants when needed. Now that those are done, let's create our command. We see there's an example command that is inside here. However, we're not going to use the example command. We're going to start from scratch, as we don't need all of the functions that are in here. I'm going to go in here. I'm going to create a new command. This new command is going to be called just drive. We're just going to call it drive.java. So we're going to create the package first. Here's our commands. We're going to create the class drive. Oops. If you remember, just like our subsystem, which extends subsystem base, our drive command is going to extend command base. So the benefits of commands is that they can be run multiple times for different scenarios based on inputs that you give it. And the subsystem classes are always running, but the commands can be stopped and called whenever required. So if I needed my robot to drive 1 meter forward, I could call a command called 1 meter forward, and it would drive the robot 1 meter forward. If I wanted to call a command, say, pick up this object, I would call that command, and the robot would know to pick up the object. Now, if I created my command properly, that it had different parameter inputs, if I had a whole bunch of objects in the up here, down there, over there, and the robot knew that, I could pass and say, okay, pick up object X, or pick up object Y, or pick up object Z, and it would then use the code to pick up that specific object that I wanted to pick up. And that's the nice benefits of commands. So first off, let's just create the base functions that are required. So we need a constructor. Let's get a comment here, see. Constructor. We're going to leave everything blank for now, because we're going to come back to this later. We then need an initialize function. Just try and remember how to spell initialize. We then need an execute function. And we need an end function. And we need a isFinished function. It's a Boolean. So if you notice, there's an error here on end. That's because it needs a parameter, and that parameter is Boolean interrupted. So what happened? Let's go over all of the different methods here and why we override them. So we have our constructor, which creates the command base. So if I had that parameter of what we're saying of X, Y, Z, right? So I'd have like int X, int Y, and Z, for example. If I set one of these high, then I would know, okay, I want to pick up that object, or I want to pick up this object. And then the command would be able to parse that data. Then we have initialize, So the reason we override it is these functions are part of the command base. So they need to be overridden in order for us to use them. If I wanted to initialize anything before the command, such as zeroing an encoder value or zeroing my yaw, or just doing something that needs to be initialized before I can run the command, this is where I put it. As every time the command is called, this will run once. If the command's continuously being called and has not finished, it won't call the initialize. So the initialize is only called the first time a command is run, unless that command has been stopped and then run again. Then you have execute. So as long as the command is running and it hasn't finished, everything inside the execute method will run continuously. So if we wanted to do a joystick drive, this is where we'd put all our drive code to drive the robot around. The end function here is what actually ends the command. So in this case, our input here is if it's interrupted. As the internal thread manager and command instance manager can tell the command, oh, there's a higher level command that is interrupting your command and you must stop your command. And then this will actually end the command. And then you have a is finished, which is a background check to check if the command is finished. In this case, we're returning false, as we never want the drive command to finish, as it should always be running.
Yeah. So if you want to, there's a question on the chat about viewing data from the sensors while running. That's what you're going to use the shuffleboard for. Okay, so that's why we created the table. And then you have the shuffleboard open when you're connected to the robot. And then you will see that sensor data. So it is part of the default project. There is somebody right now who's all the values in their shuffleboard is zero. So when we get a break here, we're gonna have a quick look at that. We have some ideas, but you know, rather than just keep discussing it in the middle of the live training, we'll stop and we'll address that as we go through. But yeah, if you want to see your data back, that's where you're gonna use the shuffleboard, and we'll show you that shuffleboard again. I'm pretty sure shortly.
Okay, so now that we've created the base drive command, even though there's no real code in it, we need to go back and modify the robot container. So you see, there's already some stuff in here, but we actually want to get rid of some, as we're not using most of it. So I'm going to get rid of all the imports here. These things here can go as well. Get rid of that. And this. And the autonomous command, because we're not using it. So you're going to end up just with a class like this. So in this class, we want to bring in our training subsystem along with our gamepad control. So I'm going to call a public static training and I'm going to call it train. Then I'm going to bring in the operator instruction. So public static OI. And then I'm going to create an instance of each of these. So train is equal to new train. And OI is equal to new OI. The reason we do this is because our robot container is going to contain all the subsystems, manual stuff such as the OI, and execute our commands based on what we want. We then want to set our default command for a training class. Set default command, new. Our drive has not been imported yet. Import drive. Let me see. So what we've done is we've created a new instance of our subsystem training, which is the training platform. We've created a new instance of the operator instructions so that we can parse the controller input. And we have created or set the default command, which we see here, of the training platform to the drive command. We now save robot container and go over to drive. Oh, but now we see there's an error in robot.java. So let's go there and see what the error is. In this case, it's this. We're just going to remove the autonomous init code for now, along with as we're not doing that right. So in drive, we are now able to fill in the full drive code. So the first thing I want to do is I want to bring in our subsystem, train equals robot container. So the reason we do it this way, OI was not imported. So what we've done here is we've created the object here, but the actual instance of this object is running in the robot container. So if we look back at the robot container, here is the instance of this subsystem and command base. If we were to create another instance here, we'd have two instances of the same code running at once, and we don't want them. We're then going to create a joystick input. This is just a variable that will hold the input from the joystick. So input, right? So this will hold the value from the controller and pass it along globally if required. Now in the main drive constructor, we're going to say this command requires train. So add requirements. So what we're saying is the command requires the subsystem training. Just like in robot container, we set the default command to drive and the requirements here, the training platform. And this ties the training platform with this command. We're not going to initialize anything as we don't need to. So first thing we're going to do and execute is this is where our main code is run, is we are going to get joystick data. So we're actually going to get the data that we need. So if we remember, we created the variable input right y, but now we need to actually send the variable to that. So OI dot get right drive y. So now whenever this code is running, our operator instruction parser will grab the current value from the right drive y-axis and pass that along to this variable. We then want to output that variable to the motor. So if we remember in our training class, we created a set motor speed method. So we're going to say train, which is the training subsystem. And you see here we have set motor speed. Here's the speed. And we're going to set the speed to whatever the value of input right is. So input right. And that's it. So now what we've done is we've grabbed the data here, parsed it to this variable, and then sent that variable to here. Now you ask, why can't I just take this and put it in here? Well, it's simple. If you wanted to do some sort of ramping calculations or other math that's required in between, such as math required to drive a three-wheeled robot around, you'd have to put it in between here. And then when the, if this function command ever ends, we want to set the motor speed to zero. So train dot set motor speed, and we're going to put zero. That's because if this command ends in the teleoff mode, we have a serious problem of something went wrong and the motor should stop. However, if something like that were to happen, the safety features on the robot would stop the motor anyways. So this is just added redundancy. And that's it for the drive command. If we were to now transport this over to the training platform, we'd be able to drive the motor around. We'd be able to see all the sensor data, just like we did with the example command project that we put up on the GitHub page. So now that we've done that, left and right.
You're going to create a command and do the joystick control, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. After that, we're going to go to vision. So before we do vision, we could probably take a 10-minute break. And
we're going to come back in. So we're going to come back
in. Come back and we'll just review any of the questions so that we can review that.
Yeah.
Right. So what we'll do is we got a few questions that we just want to go over that people have asked. We'll also give this the time if you got any questions now on what was done to add those to the chat, and we'll review them when we come back, because then what we're going to do is we're going to talk about vision, okay, and let people do a couple of things. So we'll see everybody back at the how long do you want to go through?
Well, we'll be
9 a.m. We'll see everybody back at the top of the hour at 9 o'clock. We're just going to review the notes that I have on your questions, okay, and then we'll get set up for a few other things for you, okay. So 9 a.m. and we'll be back.
Okay, welcome welcome back, everybody. I hope you had a good break. I hope it wasn't like mine, which it was filled with 1,000 different questions from different people. So just a couple of things that were coming up in the chat, all right? And some things we're just gonna wait and address. So after we do vision, we're gonna discuss the driver workstation and differences between driver workstations and why we have certain ones and why we don't here, because we are doing development work here for multiple robotics competitions around the world, okay? So we're creating stuff and testing stuff for different people. So we'll develop that. There was a question, and I'm sorry, I don't know who you are, because when you guys put in anonymous attendee for me, it really doesn't help me, so we can't get personal, and we like to be personal when we do things, about not getting any data in the shuffleboard. So with the shuffleboard is when you install VS Code from the links on our docs page, okay, that, and you follow those steps, it's going to install and put 3 shortcuts on your desktop, okay? The 2 shortcuts that we actually use and are required will be the VS Code, so it'll have the WPI lib icon with the VS Code, and it'll create the shuffleboard. So there'll be a shortcut there for the shuffleboard. The shuffleboard will be blank, right, until you are populating it in the tables that you have and putting in your code. If you're popping that up into your system using the default project and you're seeing everything in the shuffleboard but no data, then probably right now we either have some form of connection issue. So if it pops up and you see it, you would be connected to the VMX, okay? But if you're not getting any data, then there is no data coming from the sensors. So without a screen capture or something, we really can't tell what you've got there. So if you're still having difficulty with that autonomous attendee, because that's the only person I know who you are, then you know, send us a screen capture. You can email us because it was on the first slide or whatever, and we'll work through that with you, and we'll make sure that everything gets up and running for you, all right? Okay, so there's a lot of stuff here. We'll do a review at the end, and we're gonna cover a couple of different things. So what James is gonna do now is we're gonna flip over and start to discuss the camera, okay? So on day one, we went over the SR Pro camera and the camera installation, how you're gonna use the ribbon cable to put that on, and then we use an HDMI cable so that you can put that anywhere you want on your robot. On the test jig here that we've got, we do have the camera set up. Did we take it still in the case or did we put one out of the case too?
Oh, in the case.
Okay. We've put ours into the 3D printed case. That case is actually the prototype, so all new collections going forward will have the camera all hooked up and put into a case for you. Okay. Our issue right now was just trying to get the right cable made for you so that it was flexible and we could do this in the robot world. So there's a lot of little things that we look at when we're developing this stuff and putting it together. So I'll pass that on to James to discuss vision, and he'll do a couple of vision samples with you and take you through that. And back to James.
So we're just gonna do 2 different ways to do vision. We're gonna do a simple one where we just put the vision onto the shuffleboard screen. And then we're going to create a OpenCV thread running on the robot controller. So first thing we're gonna do is, I'm back in robot.java in the robot initialization. So there's 3 main commands that we're going to use to create the camera. So we need the camera server docket instance start auto capture. So essentially, that's all you really need to turn on the camera. However, we're going to add a little script so we can set the camera size and everything to what we want it to be. So I'm gonna use some OpenCV here. So CV sync. So this import CV sync. And then we also now we want to display the camera, so we're gonna use CV source output stream is equal to camera server instance video, and then we're gonna name it camera. Our width is gonna be 1280. Of course, you don't want your actual camera to be 720p while your robot's doing stuff, as it's going to hog your bandwidth pretty good. But just for this example, we are going to show it in 720p. All right, so let's now connect to the robot. Let's Sometimes it takes a while.
Right, and it's a good point what James said. Just remember that in this example right now, he's going at the full resolution of the camera.
No.
Is it not the full?
No.
Oh yeah, we can go a little bit more.
You go like 4K.
Yeah, we can go 4K. So, but just remember that you wanna limit what you're grabbing to what you need so that you're not tying up bandwidth, right? So there's no need to go full bore here.
I'm now going to deploy the code to the robot.
Wrong target.
So, hello guys, good morning. Is OpenCV already installed? So there's two installations of OpenCV. There's an OpenCV 4, which is pre-installed in the WorldSkills image on the NavX, which is for if you want to do localization testing in the Raspberry Pi itself. And then there's OpenCV, which is pre-installed into the WorldSkills WPI package here. So OpenCV, you can see here, you have the CS core. That is your OpenCV built into the code here. So you can run your scripts inside the code here and get the output straight away to your project.
I hope that answers the question.
Okay, so now we've deployed to the robot. Now we don't have to open anything to display it. We just need the shuffleboard really. I'm gonna open shuffleboard manually. Now, if you open shuffleboard manually, sometimes you'll have to go to File, Preferences. Inside preferences, you look for network tables, and by default, it'll be localhost like this, right? And you'll see not connected. So what you'd want to do is you go to preferences, network tables, and you change this to the IP address of your robot. And now you can see I'm connected. And we can also see the values coming from the training tab. Now, if we want to add a camera, there's these dashes on the left here. We're gonna open it. If you remember, we are using camera server. So I'm gonna go to camera server. And here you can see there's USB camera 0 and there's camera. I'm gonna take camera as that's what we defined in our code. might have to enable the robot. So let's open up the okay, so as we can see here now, we have the camera, but I want to get rid of this and the command here. And we can make this bigger. If you notice, the camera output is a bit blurry and it's upside down, which is okay, because we can flip it later if you wanted to in the code. And here we can see our bandwidth. So I'm running at 4.62 megabits per second. That's because, if you remember, we are running it at 720p. If we were to run at a lower resolution, our bandwidth would go higher, and we could also increase our FPS if we wanted to. So if I were to turn this drive train, we can actually see the camera send us the feedback that we're looking for. So you can see it's pretty responsive. All right, so let's turn this off and go back to the vehicle. So that's one way to do the camera. Now let's look at a different way, which is using a thread and some OpenCV extra scripts. So I'm going to create a new thread. Oops. Okay, so we're going to go USB camera equals camera server dot get instance dot start automatic capture. So this opens up the camera and starts the automatic capture that we're looking for. Now we're going to set some parameters of the camera. So camera dot set resolution. And we're going to set the resolution to 640.
By 480, I bet.
Yep.
All right. I remember when I got my first computer that had 640 by 480 resolution on the screen. And believe it or not, it had four colors. It was awesome.
So we've set the resolution of the camera to 640 by 480, and we set the FPS to 30. Now I'm going to create the CV sync. Equal to camera server dot get instance dot get video. As you see, it's somewhat similar to what we did before. CV source. Stream. So in this case, we're going to call the video grayscale. I'm going to create a new mat. So mat source is equal to new mat. And mat output. Let's import mat here. So mat is another function of OpenCV. So while thread dot interrupted. We're going to run this. So if the CV, okay, image proc. Color source output image proc dot color BG and then output stream dot put frame output. Okay, and then we have this, which is our okay, so let's go over this little OpenCV script here pretty essentially. So we create a new thread. So this will run a thread constantly on the robot. We're creating a camera. We're setting the resolution of the camera along with the FPS. We're grabbing the camera. We're creating an instance of a grayscale. We created some new mats, so a source and an output. So I'll create a source and an output video. We're then checking if the thread is interrupted. If it is interrupted, it'll just ignore this and it won't do anything. Otherwise, if we're good to go, it checks to make sure that there is a frame. We then set the output source, so the output here, using the source image, and the output is the location that it gets put. And we're changing the output to a gray, so a grayscale output. And we'll be putting the actual video along with the grayscale image right next to each one. Let's now deploy this to the robot. There is no ROS pre-installed. You'd have to create your own image. We are currently working on our own ROS node, but it won't be ready for this world scale.
Too much work right now.
Okay, so let's open up Shuffleboard again to have a look. Here we have Shuffleboard. Here's our training stuff. We're gonna open up the left tab here again, look at camera server. Here we can see, here's our grayscale, and then here's our raw camera. So if we bring the raw camera in, and we bring the grayscale in, we can see them start to pop up. So let's get rid of the crosshair and tools. And same thing on this one. So if we notice, here's the normal RGB value, and then here is the grayscale. Also notice how when we change the resolution to 640 by 480, our bandwidth is now much higher, which is a good thing. And as you can see, when I turn it, it's a live feed. And that's a simple way to do a camera. Someone asked, is it possible to call a C++ function to this Java project? Technically it's possible, but you'd have to create a Java abstraction layer, so a JNI. Okay, that's it for vision.
Okay, so that's a little bit of a brief introduction to vision. As we get going, what we'll probably be doing is posting just the same way we did with World Skills in the past to get everybody started. As an example, so before, you know, we knew people wouldn't know how to read a barcode, so we put a little bit of a barcode there, but there's a lot more information available for you in general now with Vision, because you can use OpenCV and so on for this platform. So there's a lot more samples that are available for you, but we will continue to add samples and make those available to all of the teams going forward when we're going to work through it. Okay. So just, you know, a little bit of vision and a little bit of chat about the camera and so on when we're going to go forward. Okay. You want to add the three motors now?
Sure. So now we're going to program this triangular robot. So we're going to add two more motors along with the algorithm to drive a three-wheeled robot around.
So when we did the training platform the other day, we had, of course, driving one motor. So we've only had one motor. With the three-wheel drive robot that we started to build on day two, if you've got it finished now, it naturally has the three motors on it. I'm not sure if you got it on M0, M1, M2 on this.
We'll figure
that out as we go, because we got to remember how we wired it up. And so now what we're going to do is we're going to add two more motors to that. And then because this is a three-wheel holonomic drive, we need an algorithm to discuss which direction which motor goes when you want to drive the robot. So we'll have a little bit of a look at that algorithm that's built into the code as well, so that you can see it. We chose this one just to give you an example, but if you had a four motor one, you'll figure the algorithm out for that. If you had a mechanical drive robot, you would figure the algorithm out for that as well. And I'm pretty sure that we're gonna create a few more samples as we go forward. And even that, if you've got a sample that you have running and you're happy with it and you wish to share that with everybody else, feel free to give it to us and we'll share some sample code around and we'll make a nice whole community out of this. Been a little bit of nice COVID sharing, okay, is what we'll call it, to keep everybody going. And I don't mean sharing COVID, I mean because of COVID, we'll share and help everybody out. Should be careful what I say.
Yeah, okay. Making sure I have everything. Okay, so we're gonna go to the training Java. I'm just gonna use the training example for the robot code for this triangle robot, so you have the project to see it. So right now we only have one motor defined, right? I'm gonna call this this motor, and then we can call, we have to create another one, so Tynan quad, we'll name this one motor one and try it. We'll name this one motor two. Now we have to create the instances for those motors. So we have motor equals new. Now we don't have a motor two yet, so it's getting us an error, but I'm gonna leave it for now. So now let's go to the constants page to set this motors. Remember, it's in constants. So the tight end ID on this triangular robot right now is 23. So I'm going to change this to 23. Right now we have motor one defined. So we're going to go public static. I wouldn't create more than one robot companion. But you can try yourself, and if it works, you can do it. Like we said, we're not going to program a robot for you. We're just going to provide examples, as we don't give 100% solutions. Leave this blank for now. All right. Oh, I didn't want it, so I'm gonna change them to. Okay. So now we've created those, but we need to actually set the proper location that these motors are. I'm just looking at my old code to see where I have those motors plugged in. So, okay, so in this case, my motor 2 is in 0, and my motor 3 is in 1. And my motor here is actually motor 3. So this means I don't have a motor plugged into motor 2. So I'm going to leave 2 out of there. Can then save this, close it, and we're good to go here. Now I'm going to find where we did the set motor speed function call here. And I'm going to change it here. So I'm going to say double motor 1 speed. I'm going to have double motor 2 speed. I'm going to have double motor 3. I have motor dot set, in this case it'd be motor 1 speed and motor
2. So you're setting the same speed value for all 3 motors?
No.
No?
You know, there's a parameter here for motor 1. Parameter here for motor 2, parameter here for motor 3. So they're all different values.
There you go.
Set motor speed. So now that we've created that, make sure I have them. I believe 1 has to be flipped. No, we're good. Okay. So now we're going to head over to the, oh, there's an error. As you can see, we changed this. So in the drive command, it's much different. I'll comment this out for now. Actually, we're going to take it away. Okay, so let's create the algorithm for the triangular base robot. So we're in a control motor. I'm going to change this now to triangle conversion. Okay, so we have motor 1, which is going to be equal to the input left x divided by 3 minus the input of left y divided by 1.73 plus the input right x. And that is all times by 1.6. Motor 2 is equal to the input of left x divided by 3 plus the input left y divided by 1.732 plus the input right x. And order 3 is equal to minus 2 times input left x divided by 3 plus input okay, we have to define motor 1, 2, and 3. Let's go up to here. Motor constants. So, double motor 1 equals 0, double motor 2 equals 0, and double motor 3 equals 0. Okay, now you can see we have that there. So, no, it's just that the, so someone asked, how do you determine the Titan IDS 23? Do you have any corresponding description? No, it's just that this specific robot I have set to Titan ID 23. On when you get the Titan, it's by default 42, but we'll be showing you later how you can configure it to a different CAN ID if you wish. That's just the formula, well, the base formula. Oh, Derek's phone is ringing. Another question. So we have to add more to this formula now. So now we have to set up a, oh, I forgot to add another. So we're gonna have a double max. So we have to make sure there's a, we have to constrain this calculations now to between a proper minus 1 to 1 value. So I'm gonna do some more math here, so max.
Absolute
of 1. That's turned
it off when you were here?
Yes, I turned it off. It was just due to the calling.
Yeah.
So we know it's here, so we're gonna have motor 1, motor 2, and motor 3. Bunch of questions in the chat. So someone said motor one, motor two. Yeah, that's because we're defining the three motors on the robot. So Earhart says the docs.wstart.studica page is partially failing.
What was that? We're going to test that, Earhart. Could be the error 524. Interesting.
I'll check it. I'll go on the outside and check it.
I think it could just be an internet issue. I'd try again later. It could be that the server that's hosting the docs page might be doing an update or something. So I'd try again later.
Where was it failing exactly? Which point?
Creating a project. But I think it's just the update issue. Someone asked, is it possible to run subsystems in parallel and how to prioritize? So subsystems always run in parallel. It's the commands that you want to run in parallel and together or one by one. So subsystems are always running. It's just commands that you'd set to run in parallel or in sequential. And we'll be posting a guide of that later on the docs page because we don't have enough time to go over that today.
You make a note on that.
And Earhart, I do agree with you. So whether somebody is running an update. Okay, so it just popped. So you may be getting a timeout. This is live and we have multiple developers that are working on it and updating it. So quite possibly one of the guys was doing an update, but it just popped up for me. But you are correct. It seems to be timing out a little bit. So we'll just double check the server access as well. I'll make a note on the subsystems guide for you. But mine just popped up, so it's there.
Okay, so here's the conversion to drive the triangle robot around. We're not going to go into the math yet of how we came up with this formula. We might post that later. We might not. Depends. Like we said, we never provide 100% solution. We just give you the tools to do it yourself. All right. So now we're going to come back in a bit.
I could say that we're not that smart. So we did find that math somewhere on the internet. How's that?
So we're going to take a break and then we're going to come back at, let's say, 9:50 because we're going to go set up this robot on one of the quirks on the outside with a camera so you guys can see it. And we just need time to set up.
Great. So we'll see everybody at 10 to 10 then. Okay. We are live. Welcome back, everybody. Okay, so before we go on and show you some stuff in the next sections, I just want to answer a few questions and clarify a couple things for people. Number one, if you're having trouble accessing the docs page right now, that's an open source docs page. We don't host it here. So it's hosted separately by the open source people. So, you know, I would try again. It's probably Friday morning and there's a lot of people trying to access it, or they could be doing their own internal maintenance. I do show that it is a bit slow. So it could be timing out every once in a while. So just keep trying. We don't host it. It's not us because it is open source. So that's why it's there. The last thing that I just want to clarify, and we're going to do a couple of things here. We're going to drive the robot and show you how it's connected. And then what we're going to do is we're going to leave an open source Q&A. Okay, and we'll try to answer the questions as best we can in this form factor, right? And we'll make sure that we repeat the questions going forward as we do that. The one thing that I do want to clarify is what we're talking about here when we talk about, quote, driver station, all right? So remember that in order to run code on the robot or to move the robot, we must enable the robot. And in order to enable the robot, we need a way to do that, okay? So please remember here at Studica, we do a lot of different robotics competitions. And we write code and share code for different competitions. So James has been running something on his screen, if you saw it, called the FRC driver workstation. It has some modes in it that are particularly run for different robotics competition that has a different field set up than World Skills, okay? We have had some teams that have downloaded that and have been using that that driver workstation. Okay, it's got a lot of overhead in it. It's based on some stuff that we don't use. There is also what we call a World Skills Control Station. That World Skills Control Station was specifically written for our purposes for World Skills. We are going to release that probably at the start of next week and make that available to everybody. So you'll get a packaged installation for that. That has some functionality in it for the World Skills robots. So it'll look like what we've had up on the screen, but there'll be a couple less modes in it, basically. And the third thing that we sent out to a couple of people this morning, and this is what you're going to see, which is perfect for testing and running your robot right now and enabling and disabling the robot. So as an example, if we're just going to run autonomous code or quickly test with the joystick, without having to worry about anything we're looking at in the future, such as controlling all of your robots that are running at a World Skills event at once. We have a packaged up program that we'll share out shortly called the console. And with that console, this is what James is gonna use to enable his robot and disable his robot. So we will make that console available to you very, very shortly, so that you can begin to test your code on your robot. So I'll pass this back over to James.
Okay, so I'm gonna share my screen again.
You're just gonna...
Okay, so here we have the quick console control station I made up yesterday so that we can release this right away because the other one's not ready yet. And it's very simple. Here we can see the voltage of the battery that's on the robot. So right now it's 13.08 volts. So it's a little bit overcharged, which is okay. We can see that we're currently in a disabled state. Here's the IP address of the robot. However, the IP address of the robot right now is hard coded. So you must have your team number set to 1, 2, 3, 4. Otherwise, your robot won't connect. This robot status is useless because we don't currently send data from the robot back to status here, so we might eliminate this later. At the bottom here, you can see some functions. So you can quit, you can enable or disable your robot. These are hotkeys. So if I hit E on my control, my keypad here. We can see we're now enabled. Hit D, we're disabled. Then you can see the control mode. So if I hit A, which you can see here, I can now enable autonomous on the robot. So if we had an autonomous routine and we switch to autonomous mode and then we hit enable, it'll then start the autonomous code. Then there's a test mode too. We're not gonna go over test mode in this training, so we're gonna ignore it.
Okay, so just to point on that, this was one of the functionalities that that we wanted to add. If you remember in the past, if you set your robot on the court, a lot of times what happened, it would be 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, right? And the person would have to run over and hit a start button on their robot in order to start. Now what can happen here with the control system that we have implemented, all you have to do is you're connected to your robot. You know you're connected to your robot. You can see that and verify that. Okay, and if you switch that to enable, it will run the code on the robot, right? And it's nice and easy to do. We're trying to implement a system so that when we're at a World Skills event, for instance, somebody like Vasco, who's the chief expert, could sit and see all the robots. So if we had 8 courts running, right? All the robots are there, all the robots are on the courts. He can see that every robot is connected and ready to go. And he could actually hit enable and enable all of the robots, right? And then the routines would start. So you wouldn't have to stand there with the 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go, right? So we're trying to do a lot of neat functionality for the future. But for you here with this simple console, you can enable teleoperation or enable autonomous mode. And when you enable it, you're good to go. It's just the hotkeys on the bottom of the screen. Yeah. Point to remember with James is that it is 1, 2, 3, 4. We hard coded the IP address because it's just for testing and practice. So when you're going to connect to your robot, just make sure your robot is team numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. We're not at a competition event right now, so it's not going to matter. And we'll set the other one up and running probably starting next week. Okay.
Okay. And one other thing to note is this won't launch the shuffleboard like the other one will that we're developing. So you can manually launch shuffleboard. Just waiting for it to boot up. So you can see here, I have shuffleboard, it's connected. You see the inputs that's on that robot. If you remember, you're gonna have to manually set the server address. So in preferences, network tables, server. You're gonna manually set it to 10.12.34.2 to connect yourself so you can see the output. And then you can, of course, control your robot. So I'm gonna enable my robot here. You can see enabled. And I'm going to stop sharing so that you can see the robot actually drive around on the court.
So he's enabled. We're sitting in the room that we're in right now. That court is probably a good 30 or 40 feet away. We've put a remote camera on it. The court is also, by the way, through a wall. So for those people that get worried about issues with communication and so on, this is pretty damn stable. James is actually driving this robot using the remote, not a camera on the robot from first person view, but we've got a separate camera out there looking at the court. So you can see what he's moving around. We're not showing you a World Skills court. We're doing that for a reason. Because our World Skills court has some stuff on it that's not to be shown. Therefore, we're just putting it on one of our other courts. And you can see that we're just controlling it for testing and driving around. Yeah. So that's what that default code that was created this morning. All good to go for the triangle robot. And that uses the algorithm that we put in there for you.
All right.
So there you can see that you can do that. And if he hits disabled, right, then communication to the robot is disabled. So you'll see that as he moves that, we can go back to the other screen, nothing happening on the robot. So nice and quick and easy to be able to control that.
Good. Okay, so now we're going to open it up to if any questions or...
Yeah, we saved the last moment. I see we got one in the Q&A. What we'll try to do is read your things. Now, technical questions we could try to answer, but we don't have your code or anything, and we can't see what's going on, okay? So some of it's a review of what we did, so it's good. So we can go back quickly and just show you the steps to do certain things. So the first question here,
someone's asking,
I can't read it. Oh, my glasses on.
How could I connect Shuffleboard with my Java project VMX? So if we remember back to the VMX project that we had,
I'm not sure. Oh, there's lots of chat questions.
Am I sharing my screen?
Yes, I can see your screen.
Okay. Yeah, if we go back to this project that we created, so for Shuffleboard, we have the Shuffleboard section here where we create a tab called Training, and we add the widgets to the tab with their specific names and parameters and everything. And then at the end here, in this periodic, we are setting the values to them and collecting values to them. It's very simple. Someone else asked.
Okay, Sheldon wants to know, do you guys have a fully example? There is no, you need to define fully assembled, Sheldon. So we have provided to you some step files. We did that on day one. Those step files are base robot examples is what they are. So different types of chassis that you can create, okay, with what's provided in the World Skills Kit. We do not provide examples of robots for challenges, okay? And we don't do that for a reason, and that is that we don't give solutions to any challenge. By providing examples, what happens is people tend to think that we're giving them information. So there are build tips there. There's some step files there that we provide that will show you different mechanisms going forward. As we do curriculum, we have something called data sheets or tech sheets. So we may build a lift mechanism or a mechanism that goes up and down with the parts and give that to you as an example. At this point in time for World Skills, you have a collection with parts, you have CAD files, and you are expected to come up with your own design. So on our step files, we gave you a four-wheel drive chassis and a three-wheel drive chassis, and that's generally what you get for a World Skills robot. Okay. Anwar says, does Shuffleboard, Driveboard, et cetera, also work in C++?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Here, I'm going to actually post the API document for it in the chat, and you can have a look at that.
Right. So yes, James is going to post the API document in the chat. So there it is. Remember that we are licensing the WPI libs to make everybody's life easy. Okay. So if it's not World Skills specific, it's general. There's the docs on how to do that for C++. See what the next question is, and I just got to pass a piece of information on that I just got.
So someone asked, are we meant to build our own grabbers? Ideally, you'd want to design your own object management system that you'd 3D print or use a laser cutter to cut out some acrylic, as we don't like giving specific set object management systems. And the reason for this is we don't know the design of the robot they're going to build. And therefore, if you provide it in a ready-to-go kit, it might not be interactive with your robot, which can cause issues. So that's why most of the time we allow teams and competitors to design and build their own object management systems.
Or
3D printed and such.
Yeah, okay, so Sheldon, we cannot discuss what you are allowed or not allowed to do for any particular competition. That'll come out in the CID document for that competition. I see that we do have Vasco. So Vasco is the chief expert on, and Bob was on. Bob is the skilled competition manager. If you have specific questions for this, what you need to do as an expert is you need to go onto the experts forum, right? And you can ask those questions, all right? Because that is where the rules are laid out for what can be done or cannot be done when you do the World Skills event. Okay, different events are different for different countries, and the World Skills event can be slightly different as well. Okay, so if you read a CID, so the first thing I would do is get yourself a competitor information document. You can go on that form and get them. You will see what is expected of competitors in the past and what competitors have been required to do and what they're not allowed to do. But if you go back to what I did on day one, when I talked about the criteria, the object management system and your development and design of it, for instance, is part of the scoring criteria, okay? So, you know, you're provided here, because I know that this is your first time at World Skills with the collection, and you have design limitations and constraints that must be done with that collection at this point, but I cannot discuss any specifics for the event that will happen next for World Skills. Those will come out in the competitor information document. But if you get your hands on some of the older ones, so for you in Canada, you can try to contact Kevin and ask him for copies, or like I said, ask on the form. They will provide you with that information. You can see how it's been done in the past. That would be the best thing to do. Yep.
Any more? Looks like all the docs pages are down.
Yeah, it does look like all the docs pages are down right now for some reason. So, bad time for that to happen. Create ourselves an offline installer, maybe. When I do the LMS, it'll be separate. Yeah. So they must be doing maintenance on the server this morning. I wouldn't doubt it. Okay. But they should be back up. They are just a bit slow.
Where is the best place in the project to put image processing algorithms? So the best place would be to create a subsystem called Vision. And in that subsystem, you'd have separate methods or functions where they do specific image processing. For example, you'd create a script in a method called read barcode, and then the return would be the value of the barcode. Then you create another script that could say, read this object image that I've taken, and then find the object that I'm looking for with its X, Y coordinates. And then it returns those X and Y coordinates to you.
Right. Okay. Okay, next question. Do you have a date on when the two documents are coming out for Shanghai? That has nothing to do with us, okay? So that would be to the chief expert and the skill competition manager for when those documents are planned to be released, okay?
You contact them or...
Right. I'm not sure, Jonathan, if you're one of the experts, if you're the expert for your country, but they would have that answer for you, and they would be able to go on the experts forum and ask that question, and then you will get that response. Okay.
Frank says it's Bob that will decide.
Yeah. So it's Bob. Bob's in charge.
We'll be posting a link when we send all the recordings today to the actual install for that little control center command based system that we showed you today to enable and disable the robot. It only works on the Windows computer, unfortunately, so you want to make sure that you use a Windows device, as we have not compiled it yet for a Mac or a Linux device.
I don't have one. Hmm? Oh, we do have a Mac device, don't we? Tony does. If there's any more questions, we're just in the Q&A session. Please feel free to ask them. We'll answer them best that we can in the live talk period, as opposed to anything else. Sorry, I'm getting chatted by Frank, and I don't understand his question. Yes, that is a good question, Frank. I was going to actually discuss that with you. So just to let everybody know, while I have you here, and you don't have to answer this question now, but we are going to be conducting future training sessions going forward, all the way up to Shanghai. We are going to just do probably, and I think rather than do 1 week, we'll do smaller, specific, as I call it, either mission task or, sorry, basic skill set training sessions. So if we can get some feedback based upon this on what you would like to see, we can do that as we go forward. And how you want it, you know, to be looked at. You must remember that if you get a CID document, you cannot ask us to do training on a specific individual task, but we can do a general overall session. So as an example, a four-wheel drive holomic drive robot, we could sit and code a base robot for a 1 hour session. Okay, so we could look at that.
Someone's asking, is there a tool for image processing like the Vision Assistant in LabVIEW? There is a tool, however I can't show you the tool because the docs page is down and I can't really show it, but yeah, it's literally a tool that you can launch and it creates a tool chain that will then be able to output a value for you over network tables. But unfortunately, because the docs pages are all down for a server update, I can't show you, but we can it'll be posted later to our docs page on how to use tools like that. It's not exactly like the one in LabVIEW. It's a little bit more hands-on work that you have to do. So it's not a drag and drop, here you go.
It's not a drag and drop like Vision Assistant, but even that, when you were working in LabVIEW, the Vision Assistant had a lot of overhead, and if you actually ran Vision Assistant code on the real, you probably were not performing to the best of the capability. So it's a little bit more of a lower level, but there is some documentation there on the docs page that will take you through that from Vision. Okay. Somebody, Bob, are you in the chat right now? Because people want your email address. So if you want to share that with everybody, you could post that to everybody in the chat, okay? So that they can begin to ask you some questions. Let me just see if Bob's there. He is there, yes.
Good morning.
Oh, wait.
Good morning, Bob.
How you doing?
Good, how are you?
Okay, my email is bobtone@rogers.com. But specific questions should be going through the forum so that...
Let me do something for you here, Bob.
I promoted him to a panel.
Okay.
So if the question's coming from an expert, post it in the forum. If the experts are not yet registered, then my email, bobtone@rogers.com, and then I will post both the question and the answer to the forum so that when they're... people join into the forum as they're assigned by their countries, then they'll be able to see the history of the questions. But if you have a question and you know you're the expert, but you're not yet registered as the expert, send the question to me, bobtone@rogers.com, and I will strive to answer it and then share it through the forum. And regarding the competitor information document, at present, the goal is to have it available 1st of December. But that's not written in stone or anything, but that is the goal.
All right, thanks, Bob. I'm gonna show one last thing here for people, and that is how to configure the Titan. So first off, we're gonna need our nice, long USB cable that comes in your collection. To unravel it here. As you can see, there is a USB-C side and a USB-A side. The A side will plug into your computer. And the C side will plug into the USB port on the Titan. Let me plug it in here. Open up the app so I can show you guys. Okay. So here is the configuration app for the Titan. As we can see here, it's found the Titan with the CAN ID 42. And now I can hit connect to actually connect to the Titan. I'm now connected. So you can see here, my CAN ID is 42. And I have not set a current limit or an internal encoder resolution. I can also enable the limit switch inputs on the Titan. Remember that if you enable these switches, what will happen is if we plug in a switch to here and it hits that limit, it will stop the motor in that direction. So if you enable it, it enables that. Then you have NO and NC. So this is a normally open or a normally closed. If we remember on the, don't have one here anymore, but if we remember on the limit switch, there is a normally open and normally closed contact. You want to choose the option. By default, it's normally open. And then this sets it to normally closed. So that way we can invert the logic on the controller. Then you have automatic bounce back, which is not activated yet. But what would happen when it is activated is that if you were to hit the limit, it would bounce off the limit switch a little bit to prevent constant contact or a hard stop. Here where you can set the idle mode for your motors. It's set to coast. You can change it to brake if you want. Here's the S-curve sensitivity. So this is how well the motors will react to changes in throttle. So I wanted to change my CAN ID. I can just type a new one in here. So Derek, give me a number between 1 and 63.
57.
If I choose 57, I can now hit save configuration. And then I got a pop-up that says your configuration will be saved to the device. It just took a while to save, but it did it. And now you can see up here at the top, my ID is 57 instead of 42. So some other things you can look at here are, we can update the firmware for the Titan. So if I hit check for updates, it says my firmware is up to date, so I don't need to update. However, if your firmware is not up to date, it'd say there's a new firmware available. Would you like to download it? Upon which you could say yes, then it will download. And then a button will come up here saying upgrade, and you hit upgrade, and it will upgrade the controller. So there's some other things here, such as system info, where you can see your unique ID, which is also your serial number. You also can see your firmware version, the hardware version, your hardware type here, then you get a protocol version. And then there's just an about section here with the link to the docs page. One thing to note is there's this little light up here that if you hold it, it will blink the light on the Titan. So if I stop sharing here and we switch to the status light on the Titan. If I were to hold that light down, you can see it's flashing white. This can show you that you have a good connection with the Titan and everything's good to go. If I let go, it starts flashing normally. And that's how to use the update app. The update app can be installed by going to our docs page, which unfortunately is down right now due to the server update. But once it is up again, the update app is there where you can then configure the Titan along with updating it if required.
They're shutting everything down for the US election.
Could be.
Never know. So they all got Bob's email address for him, right? Good to go. He told them to post in the form, which is good. That's where it needs to go. Use the form, please.
You can drive the robot around until someone has another question. So we're just going to show the robot driving around until another question pops up that someone wants to ask. Yeah, so the limit switches on the Titan, when you hit enable, it can only be configured for all the motors or none, yeah. We might push an update later where we can change it to individual motors, but for now it's all the motors or none. But if your limit switch is on, it's by default pulled high. So there is no issue of if you don't hook up the limit switch, that it's going to turn off the motor. Someone asked, is it possible to install other libraries? Do you have a tutorial? Does it use a similar approach to using Command Palette? Currently, there are no other libraries that you need to install. However, if you do need to install other libraries, you would be using the similar approach as the Command Palette managed vendor library. But if you're installing a library that's outside the system, you'd most likely have to manually import it in and then as a separate folder and then import it as a normal library would in the project. And knock the wobble go over.
Did you knock the wobble go over? Okay, so it looks like we don't have a lot of questions, so we'll finish off a half hour early. Frank is going to send you all out a feedback questionnaire. We would appreciate that. With that, he's also going to try to ask you some questions about types of things you would like to see in the training, It can be what we call general specific, not specific general. So you can't, you know, ask us how to do this, but you could say, how would I use vision to read a barcode and move the robot 15 feet, for instance? And we are developing a bunch of little exercises like that for you, and we'll put them together. As an example, all week after this, I've been working on a section called mechanisms and linkages, where we're looking at using parts of the channel and the design in the collection and building different types of mechanisms or linkages that come up and down, and then we'll generate some sample code for those for people as well. So I'll just make sure I'm not getting chatted here on anything else. And no, we're good. So with that, I'd like to thank everybody for training all week. We'll still keep the Discord open for the rest of the day. And when you get going, when you get your collections, if you're having any specific questions, please let us know right away. And we'll see what we can do. I just will reiterate one last thing.
So someone's asking, since I don't have a VMX Pi yet, can I use a, no.
No.
Because you need a specific VMX Pi to have the script and the robot manager and everything set up correctly. Otherwise, it will not work.
Right. Okay. So, yeah. Okay. So that'll answer that question. So stay safe, everyone, and we'll see you whenever we get to see you. I know for WorldSkills, there's a meeting on Monday where they're going to discuss a lot of things. I just will say this, and I will say this for Bob. If you know who your expert is, if you are an expert or will be an expert, please get on the experts form and use that to discuss things with the rest of the experts, okay? So thank you very much, and stay safe, everybody.
And Frank might want to say something.
Is Frank, do you want to say anything?
No, I don't. I just want to
hi, Frank. Say
hi, Derek, and hi, James, and hi, everyone out there. I don't see your pictures there, but I just thought I wanted to say thank you, and also to wish you all well, and we'll talk to you soon. We, you know, I think COVID has been a learning experience for all of us. And one of the things that we learned is that we could actually do a lot of this training pretty effectively online. So, you know, definitely expect more of this from us. And if you have any suggestions at all, please send us an email and let us know, you know, what else we could be doing for all of you to help out. You know, we certainly know that some of you, a lot of you don't have any of the equipment. And so we're hoping that on the next training that we announce that you will have the equipment, because obviously, as you can see, you know, going through the training without the equipment is pretty difficult for you. And so that's about it. Again, just so you can see me and know that I've been watching and listening and trying to get a good feel for how things are going. And I think that James and Derek have done a great job. And, you know, we certainly, everyone has been very, very thankful of that. So once again, goodbye, everyone. And all of you take care.